as Greg and Maddie said, I am a folk art apprentice, or was a folk art apprentice with Vesterheim in the inaugural program there, and then received a grant to study in Norway. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about what I did this past year. So if we hop on over to the next slide, we'll see just a little bit of a hint of what is to come, but this is a picture of me in Valdres at the Folk Museum, doing some rose mulling on my face. And so that's kind of what I've been experimenting with recently. So that's a little bit of what I will talk about today. So, first things first, in the next slide, you will see a map that many of you are probably familiar with. It's a map of the world. And, you know, my ancestors were a part of the move of lots of Norwegians and Scandinavians in the late 1800s mid to late 1800s to the Midwest in the United States. And in fact, so my mother's side of the family comes from Gudbrandsdal and Romerike, and they moved to Waterloo, Iowa. And my father's side of the family came from Valdres to Decorah, which is where Vesterheim is located. So that's kind of where my Vesterheim connection started, is that Decorah connection. And in fact, in the next slide, you'll see that my family went from being neighbors in Valdres in Norway to being neighbors in Nordnes, Iowa. There are a few of the farms marked there. So they just moved all together and stayed together and married each other in the same neighborhood. So I think it's probably a familiar story to a lot of people here today. But then because of all of this, I really grew up around this Norwegian heritage. So in this next slide, you will see a few pictures, a few samplings of my youth. So this is a family photo with Norwegian sweaters gifted to us or purchased in Norway. And on the right, that's me in my little bunad. I wore it to school one day. I wore my bunad to school, and I am still remembered as the girl who wore that Norwegian outfit to school back in fourth grade. So that's what I get for being really interested in my heritage. But, you know, there's a lot of good stuff that has come out of it. I was really really surrounded by this heritage in my family. There are so many traditions that, you know, holiday traditions and food and art. You know, we had rose mulling all over our house. And it was something that I was always drawn to. So then, you know, this interest in art and rose mulling, then I started kind of experimenting with a few different things. So in this next slide, you'll see that I tried wood burning. I tried the red bowl piece on the bottom was from my first ever Vesterheim class in, I think it was 2019. So as I mentioned in the beginning, I started rose mulling when I was in middle school, but it was all self-taught from books and just figuring things out. Didn't really have a bunch of YouTube stuff to work with at that point. So I was just figuring it out. And, you know, working with face painting more recently, and just trying to see different ways that I can apply these traditional techniques. So that led to then me taking Vesterheim classes and applying for the apprenticeship program that they started back in 2019, 2020. And so, in this next slide, you'll see Vesterheim, the lovely Vesterheim, and a group of my fellow apprentices and myself, and we're in the collection, getting to get up close and personal with the Vesterheim collection and learning a whole bunch. And then through that, I applied for the Kurtage grant, which was to help fund a trip to Norway to study these historical pieces in person and maybe study with some modern day rose mullers in Norway. And I got it. Yay. So very, very thankful for that. That was, you know, I applied for that in late 2021 and then started planning my trip for 2022. So then that's kind of where I where I go in this next slide here, the goals that I had for this trip. I knew that I wanted to travel to a bunch of different areas to kind of see. You may be familiar with rose modeling, like each region has a different distinctive style. And I wanted to see as many of those as I could and the regions that they came out of, you know, because it's one thing to learn about them from books or from classes or, you know, all the different videos you can watch online. But it's a very different thing to be in the place itself and see the landscape and see the traditional farms and all of these things where these arts grew from. So I wanted to, you know, go to these places and check out these different styles. I wanted to go to as many museums as I could. And also, you know, if I could find some family members or friends of family, distant family relatives, that I could see art that they have in their own homes. I wanted to connect with artists in Norway, Rose Mahler's practicing in Norway right now. And then also just talk to as many regular old Norwegians as I could to see what their perspectives were on art and folk art and what it means to them in their daily lives, or what it doesn't mean to them. And then finally, I wanted to continue this exploration of using rose modeling techniques and traditional folk art techniques on my face, using my face as a canvas for rose modeling and painting. And then, you know, trying to spread the folk art to as many people as possible by sharing what I've learned on social media. So then that brings us to the next section of the presentation, which is why face painting? What are we even talking about here? Isn't that for kids at fairs? And the answer is yes. And you know, we're used to seeing things like this at fairs, at school, you know, school functions and birthday parties. But there's also a really vibrant face painting community online. So in the next slide, you'll see some Instagram captures that I've taken. These are two artists that I love to follow on Instagram who really do some creative things and using brush stroke techniques and lots of floral things, but also they do all sorts of other things too. But, you know, there's a huge community online kind of playing with performance art, painting on your face, you know, just seeing all the different things you can do and what works and what doesn't work. And then I think also what's really interesting is there is a historical connection here. So not only is there this modern social media trend, but in the next slide, you'll see it's probably maybe a familiar image to some of you from the Vikings TV show, but also, you know, just kind of popular culture in general. Oftentimes depictions of Vikings have these, you know, intricate face painting things. And there is some historical account. There is some evidence that this is rooted in history. There are some accounts that nod to, especially the dark coal around the eyes. So I think, you know, whether or not it's entirely historically accurate to be doing rose modeling on your face, I think it is a fun thing to experiment with and think about what those long, long, long back ancestors might have been doing to decorate their bodies and faces in different ways. So then I'd love to show you in this next slide the my first experiment with face painting and rose modeling. It was kind of in the height of COVID lockdown, and I was getting stir crazy like the rest of everybody. And I started, I just thought one day, should I paint my face? And I did. So let's just take a look here at the video real quick and see that first experiment.
Tysta ensamhet Var skal jeg nøyen finne Bland søg som ingen vet Skal mine dår
All right. So that was my first kind of jump into painting on my face. And from there, I loved it so much. I started doing it more and more and more and experimenting more and having fun trying out the different things. So, you know, this was an example of a telemark style. But I started dabbling in other styles too, and Hollingdahl and Gudbrand's doll, and just seeing what I could make work on my face. So that brings us to the next section of the presentation, which is the trip. The trip I took in September of 2022 to Norway. So throughout this portion of the presentation, you will see different images that I took on my trip. So this one here is from the Living Museum at Bygdøy in Oslo. So throughout you'll just see different sections. Actually, yeah, if we can hop to the next slide here. The first stop that I took was Oslo. And so again, an image from the museum there. And what I did in Oslo, you know, I was getting myself situated. I stayed at an Airbnb and had nice chats with my hosts there and got a feel for what they thought about art and art in Norway. And I also visited the National Museum and the Norsk Folk Museum. Let's go on then to this next one I'm very excited about. This was my first Oslo-inspired work. So this is a piece that I saw in the Folk Museum at Bygdøy. An old magic book, like magic shapes and symbols on it too. A lot of them might mean protection. There are other things for, you know, all sorts of things that these symbols can mean. Often they're protection symbols. So my lovely father was the, hi dad, he's watching today. He was the muse for this project, and agreed to let me paint some of these symbols on his face. So I really liked the idea of transferring these protection symbols from this box that's, you know, going to hold these protective items or things that you want to protect, and putting them on a physical form, on the human form. Another thing someone noticed, I didn't even do this on purpose, but there was like that cross mark on the bridge of the nose that I took directly from the image of the box there. Somebody noted to me that that looked like a Viking helmet, like kind of the nose piece of a helmet. I don't know if that's an accurate Viking helmet, but I liked that idea too. And then I actually did I didn't put a great picture of it, but on the side of his forehead there, I wrote 2023, and the box I think was from something like 1693. So, taking inspiration from this old object and making it new. So then I got to use my mom as my next muse. And my mom is a lover of the color blue. She is also watching today. Hi, mom. And so she agreed to let me do a porcelain inspired work on her. And this is from the National Museum in Oslo. These are examples of things where I have done the work already. I've painted on, this was actually the first time I painted on someone else's face as opposed to my own. So it was fun being able to maybe focus a little bit more on detail and not be so like, trying to just get those lines right on my face. But I had a lot of fun doing those, and there will be videos coming out of those painting processes. But right now it's just these images. And then I decided more recently to do, another piece inspired by some things I saw in the Oslo museums. So on the next slide, you will see another porcelain piece. It's a chocolate pot, and it has this lovely gold topper on it. And I decided, I was really getting into gel nail painting, and I decided to make some nail art inspired by that piece. And there is actually a video for that as well. So if we want to, it's a quick little video.
Oh, Manny, inspired by this chocolate pot I saw in the Vesterheim feed in Oslo, Norway to emoji.
Cool. So one thing that I found really fun in making these videos is I forgot to mention this, that when I got to Norway, I rented an electric vehicle. I thought I was renting this nice little car for myself. I was doing a little solo trip and just needed a little car. And they ended up giving me this big minivan, which the people I visited thought was very funny that I was traveling all by myself through Norway in this huge minivan. But it was really cool to experience this electric vehicle that, you know, a lot of people drive electric vehicles in Norway. It's very, very common. But I had never driven one before. And so learning how to use the charging stations and planning your trip so that you hit the charging stations along the way. But the other great and somewhat unexpected fun thing about that was that through these drives across the country, I got to listen to Norwegian radio, which was so fun for me. I love music. I love learning languages by listening to music. So I really made a point to listen to a lot of Norwegian music on the radio. And so I've been having a lot of fun plugging those songs in that I collected on my trip and using them in these videos. So that song you just heard was on the radio a lot while I was there. Then the next stop that I took after Oslo was Valdres, which, as I mentioned earlier, is where my father's side of the family is from. So I actually got to meet up with some family relatives there. I visited the Valdres Folk Museum and then got to see different relatives' collections in their homes, in their family farms. In fact, speaking of farms, this next slide, you will see me and my dad at the family farm in 1992. My dad is helping me walk in front of this flagpole and then scooch on over to 2022. What's that? 30 years later, you get to see me walking all by myself. So it was very fun to see, you know, this place that I had only seen pictures of, but I had been to before, but now I got to see it with my own big grown-up eyes. So while I was at that farm, I got to just go in their basement, basically. And so take a look at these pictures that I took of just items from the farm that were just sitting in the basement. Like they're not even, they don't, you know, I would think of those as like, oh, these are my most prized possessions. And for them, they have even more beautiful ornate items up in the regular house. And these are just things that were used on the farm for 100 years. And it was very cool to see these well-worn, well-used items at this family farm. So then next we went, well, I went with a distant cousin of mine to the Valdres Folk Museum. And so I took a lot of pictures and videos there. And one of my favorite things I did is I did a face painting while at the living museum of this. It's like a sled, I think, in like on the grounds of the museum. And that was something very special about being surrounded by all of these old, old, old buildings and doing this painting. And it was a beautiful day. So it was all around great day. And I did that one there, and there is a video coming for that as well. But in the next slide, you'll see another video that I made of something inspired by a piece that I saw in the Valdres Folk Museum. But I kind of chose more modern music. So this is a deviation. I didn't use the Norwegian pop music for this one. It was more of a spooky Halloween themed video.
I'm trying not to go off the deep end. I don't think you ought to give me reasons. I've been trying not to go off the deep end. I don't think you want to give me. I've been trying not to go off the deep end. I don't think you want to give me reasons. I've been trying not to go off the deep end. I don't think you want to give me.
Cool. So yeah, that was just another example of some of the art that's been coming out of the travels. And that was, as I said, kind of trying to bridge the gap a little bit of being very much traditional, inspired by all the traditional stuff and using Norwegian music. And this was kind of maybe trying to bridge that gap and reach a bit of a wider audience, but still showing them that source material, the piece from the saddle from the museum in Valdres. So this final slide about Valdres, it kind of is where this idea of opening up these cultural conversations happened. As I said, I visited this museum with a distant cousin of mine, and we started really talking about bunads and what makes a bunad, what constitutes a bunad. And they just happened to have this amazing exhibit at the Valdres Folk Museum, where there were several fantasy bunads. And the image on the left is a man from Sudan. I believe he was a refugee from Sudan, and he moved to Norway in 2008, I think. And he created this kind of fusion bunad of these two cultures. He's now an artist living and working in Norway, and considers himself, you know, Norwegian. He lives in Norway, has lived in Norway for a very long time. And he combined the traditional costuming of both of these places that he calls home into this one outfit, one item, one art piece. And that started some really interesting conversations about what you can call a bunad. And we'll get a little bit more into that later, but this is where those wheels really started turning for me, of trying to understand where, you know, your average Norwegian might stand on those ideas. So then I moved on to Hallingdal and Voss regions. So this was a long cross-country drive. It was amazing. The sights were just incredible. And what I did there was I visited the Hallingdal Museum and the Voss Folk Museum. So I don't have a video for this section. I just have some images for you on this next slide that are examples of source material that I will be able to use now. I have thousands. I think I have over 3,000 pictures that I took when I was in Norway, and lots of videos as well. So source material that I can return to for many, many, many years. You know, I'm very interested in this piece on the left. It was kind of a panel of a door like you see on the right. But to me, it's very reminiscent of waves, ocean waves and water. And then in the center, there seems to be a shell. So for me, very inspiring, cool. I had never seen anything like that from, you know, a traditional piece. So yeah, I'm super excited to paint something from that. So then my next stop on the trip was Strandvik, where I visited the studio of Anne Hesvik, and she is a painter who, a Rose Mahler, who has taught at Vesterheim. She, in fact, was my first class that I ever took at Vesterheim. So if you remember back that red bowl that I showed very close to the beginning, that was from the Anne Hesvik class. So I think in the next slide, you'll see just some images from her beautiful, beautiful studio. She has converted this old church into her studio. And so you can see during the daytime there, you can see out onto the fjord, and it's just amazing. So we sat there and painted together during the day. And, you know, she has her artwork all around, super inspiring. On the left is just an example of the notes that I was taking during my time with her. So she spoke to me about composition a lot, and showing me how, like, if you have a piece that's a circle, breaking it up into different sectors, into different quadrants, and even smaller sections as well. And, you know, where you need the interest to be, where it needs to be rooted. One idea that really stuck with me is how like the stem needs to be thin enough that it's still a delicate plant, but thick enough that it can actually hold up the flower. Sometimes we forget that we are actually depicting plants when we are, when we're doing this rose modeling, it just becomes C strokes and S strokes. And so remembering that, hey, like this stem needs to be substantial enough to hold the flower that it is supporting. So then in the next slide, this is one of my favorite things that happened on the trip. I picked a piece from Anna's studio and decided to turn that into a video and face painting project. So the piece on the right, just take a look real quick. That is the inspiration piece that she had in her studio that I chose to work with. And then on the left is an image of what I did with it. But let's take a look at the video in the next slide of the whole project.
Av og til når ljuset slukner og ingen her kan se. Ja, da tillegg stjernene som bare vi to så. Jeg skal døve din sorg med min sang. Om ikke I dag, så en annen gang. Jeg skal døve din sorg med min sang. Om ikke I dag, så en annen gang. Av og til når kvelden skumrer, og ingen deg kjær. Ja, da hører du min sang. Så vet du egen Jeg skal døve din sorg med min sang. Om ikke I dag, så en annen gang. Jeg skal døve din sorg med min sang. Om ikke I dag, så en annen gang.
Cool. So yeah, I had a lot of fun with this one for many reasons. I think the first reason was that Anna was so excited to be there with me, and she was really supportive of the things I was trying to do. And I think that video, it's a longer one, which we'll talk about a little bit later, but that's not always a good thing on social media. But I really tried to show the process of, you know, sketching the design out on my face with eyeliner, or at least like kind of an idea with white eyeliner. And then there's a part where I'm thinking about, oh, where do I want this gold streak to go? I think I want it to go right across my nose here. And then, you know, going through the thought process a little, but it does make for a longer video. These are just a few more pictures. We had, Anna invited me out to dinner, at a local restaurant to have like a very traditional Norwegian meal. And I didn't have time to wash my face. We had to go like right then, because painting of course always takes longer than you think it's going to. But, we went out and I went and had this very traditional Norwegian meal with this painting on my face. It was awesome. It was fun. It's definitely something I will remember for a very long time. So yeah, I think another really exciting thing was that, that it was fun to kind of be in the space of her studio afterward. And she was so fun, you know, recording me and taking lots of portraits of me on her iPhone and, you know, taking these slowly panning videos. So that was a really, it was a cool way to feel like, okay, now I've done the painting. I'm not just going to wash it off right away. Cause that's sometimes what I do. It's like, okay, I'm done. Okay. Wash it off. It's done. This was like, I lived in it for a while. I went to the restaurant in Norway with this, you know, Norwegian style painting on my face. And then I was in this art studio that was so incredible, surrounded by this amazing art, you know, a crackling fire, the fjord you can see through the windows, and, you know, just trying to kind of live in the space for a while with that face painting was an interesting experience. And again, an unexpected kind of output from what I was doing. So that then takes us to the final stop of the trip, which was Porsgrunn. And again, another really long drive, but just gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous drive. I really lucked out on the weather. It was, again, it was September, but it wasn't too cold. It was just right. And it was, I think it rained maybe one day the whole time I was there. It was just beautiful, unbelievable scenery. So I think I got really lucky there. But while I was in Porsgrunn, I visited the Porcelain Museum. So on the next slide, I think we can see I visited the Porcelain Museum. I went to a concert at the Schönkirche, and I visited Mona Erlandsen's studio. So on the right is just an image of kind of an example of what my notebook was like. I kept a notebook throughout the trip of different places I visited. So, you know, there's my ticket to the Porcelain Museum and a little clipping from the museum pamphlet, and then some sketches that I did from the museum. And then on the left, you should Google the church, the Schönkirche, because it is gorgeous on the outside. But I wanted to include here a picture of some of the art on the inside, because once you start looking, there is just stuff to see everywhere. And so I was really inspired by this painting along the edges of the walls. So I took a picture there to maybe do some more art later. And then that brought me to my visit with Mona at her studio. And lucky you get to see some pictures of it now in the next slide. This is actually just her studio. Is they have a villa. It's called Villa Fredness. And it's amazing. She has an Instagram page just for this villa. And she and her husband are just redoing the whole thing. And it's incredible. It is so cool seeing the before and after stuff that she does on there. But this is an image just kind of their mudroom. Can you believe it? Like, I don't know if that's what they call it, but the images on either side, she has used this kind of Rosmaling S stroke to cover all of the walls and up onto the ceiling. And you can see how the light is reflecting on the ceiling. Just an amazing room to be in. And she actually told me of, there are some sections in the room. She did all of these like gold and white strokes, but her Rosmaling teacher actually came in and did some like more black detailing on other parts of the room. So it was so fun to just sit on the floor and like look at, you know, the different sections that different artists had painted. And then in the center is an image of a painting that she has done. So she's really a fine artist. And that's one thing that I kind of want to get into here at the end of this little talk today is one of the big questions that I was trying to get into during this trip is like, what is the difference between fine art and craft? And is there a difference? And does there need to be a difference? And there are a lot of differing opinions out there and a lot of strong opinions out there. And I think I'm still forming my own. But Mona Erlandsen, her idea was very much, she is a fine artist who not too long, I think it's maybe only about 6 years ago, that could be wrong, but it's not very long ago when she started using Rosmaling in her work. So she studied fine art and she's, you know, does oil painting, and then more recently got interested in incorporating Rosmaling techniques into that painting and started studying from Rosmaling teachers in Norway. She uses a lot of nature, lots of birds and, you know, leaves different, like, but more clearly leaves than you might see in Rosmaling, where it's like, somebody says, okay, that thing that you just painted with a C stroke and an S stroke, that's a leaf. And you're like, okay, I guess it's a leaf. Whereas in her paintings, like, it's very much, that's a leaf. And then she uses the C strokes and S strokes to complement it and add to it. So it's just kind of a different approach, to using those same techniques. But yeah, I think let's go on to this next slide, and we can talk a little bit more about those final thoughts that I was having. So again, so when I went to Mona's studio, we didn't do art. I just went and sat at her kitchen table with her and drank some tea and ate some sweets. And we talked for so long about art, and what art is and what makes it fine art versus what makes it kunstfeed or craft. And then the quote that I have there, that of course it's okay, but it's not okay for me. That was from actually a talk that I had with Anna Hesvik at her studio. I think it was the last night that I stayed with her. We stayed up late into the night, just talking about all sorts of things. And one of the things that came up was like, do you consider yourself a fine artist? Do you consider yourself an artist? Do you consider yourself a folk artist? Like, what do you think about all of this? And, I think one of the things that Anna was really focusing on was copying, using designs and filling in those lines. Like, that's great. That's what she would call husflid or craft. This decorative, you know, taking a piece of furniture and painting that, that would be craft. And then, you know, maybe creating your own design and putting it on a giant canvas, that's maybe more art. And the, of course it's okay, but it's not okay for me, was Anna talking about husflid and saying, you know, it's a wonderful thing to do, but it's not what I am drawn to. She's drawn to, you know, being a fine artist. And she is. So yeah, I think another really interesting thing was just kind of delving into what the American views on all of these things are. So we talked a little bit about Bunads earlier. You know, I, as an American with, you know, very strong Norwegian heritage, I really have always thought, I want a Bunad that feels my own. I want a Bunad that I can look at it and say, that's, you know, that's where I come from. But where do I come from? Well, I was born in Minnesota. I grew up in North Carolina. So like, where, you know, my whole family's from Iowa. We're all back from Denmark and Norway. So how do I make it my own? And wanting to find something that feels like it fits me. But then you speak to Norwegians and there's a very clear feeling from many of them, or most of them, that in order to be called a bunad, it has to be a very specific thing. If you want to make a fantasy bunad, or if you want to make a folk costume, those are separate as well. So yeah, I think it's the final thing that I will, if you leave today with nothing else, I think the big takeaway for me from this whole trip was what Mona and I talked about in her studio. And that was that no matter what you do with art, no matter what you are doing with craft, the final answer always has to be respect. Respect is the big takeaway. So as long as you are being respectful to the people who came before you, the artwork that you might be referencing, all of these things, you just respect. Like, ask yourself when you're creating something, am I respecting the source material, and am I respecting the people who created it? And that's all you can strive for, really. So then these final two thoughts. Yeah, the folk art in the modern space is kind of something that I have been struggling with my whole life in folk art. In college, I was like trying to do rose mauling with glitter and just seeing what I could do with that. Yeah, and then more recently trying to bring rose mauling into the online space with Instagram and the face painting and the nail painting and all of that. And one thing that I have really struggled with is like, how do I bring folk art, this innately kind of slower thing into this really fast world. It's just quick. Everything's quick. You know, their analysis shows that 7-second videos perform the best, meaning they reach the widest audience and have the most interaction on, you know, on TikTok, on Instagram. 7 seconds. That's so short. And obviously my videos were much longer than 7 seconds. So, but I have one video where I lost all of the footage that I had taken and ended up just taking like a very short, maybe 7-second video and slapping it onto a trending sound, not any beautiful music, just like a trending sound. And it got 3 times the engagement, and 3 times the reach of any of my other videos. So just trying to figure out like, where do I stand on all of that? You know, it's an interesting thing. And I think, I'm still figuring it out. And I guess that takes me to my final thoughts here. Where do I go from here? The big question is, where do I, as this kind of social media presence that I'm trying to establish, you know, where do I fit into the folk art community, as a folk artist or as just a general artist? And I don't really have an answer to that question yet, but I think the answer maybe is just that I just need to keep trying stuff and keep learning and exploring and talking to other artists and learning from them. And so with that, I just want to say thank you so much to Vesterheim for giving me the space to do that and the opportunity to do that through this apprenticeship and through the traveling with the Kurtish Foundation. So yeah, I think I've got a thank you slide on that last one. Just thank you so much to Vesterheim. Thank you to the Kurtish Foundation. And that's all. So if there are any questions, I don't know. Just thank you so much for being here and letting me talk to you.
Well, thank you so much, Marit. That was a great presentation. I already have 2 questions for you if you're ready for it.
Great.
So I have one question that asks, what style of rose mauling, I apologize, do you predominantly paint?
That's a great question. I would say I really started with Telemark, and that's probably what I'm most comfortable with. However, I have been really interested in learning these other styles. I'm actually signed up for a class later this week with Patty Goke through Vesterheim, where we're doing a style a day, and we're touching on 4 new styles that I haven't tried before, I don't think. So I also really enjoy Vikstahl, which is a totally different vibe entirely. It's like yellow and blue and black kind of swirly lines on a more orangey background. It's very distinctive. And I have a lot of fun with that. I'm also really interested in getting more into Rogaland and American Rogaland. But I would say for the face painting, I think so far I have found that Telemark fits really well because it's asymmetrical and it kind of moves with the curves of the face better, because you know, a face is not a flat board. Yeah.
Well, thank you. I believe I'm going to open up and stop sharing the presentation so that we can talk while we're facing each other. I have another question here that says, how long were you in Norway, and are you still keeping in touch with the artists that you met there?
Great question. I was in Norway for about 2 weeks, a little bit less than 2 weeks, because there's kind of travel bump on either end. I spent 1 to 3 days in each of these locations, just kind of, and then maybe a day of driving, a day or two here, a day of driving, a day or two there. And yes, I am keeping in touch with these artists. I hope to for a long time. They were so amazing and welcoming and bringing me into their spaces and showing me what they do. Again, I would suggest you give @VillaFredness a follow on Instagram. I think Mona also has her own social media page. And then Anna also has a social media Instagram, and you can see some of her painting there. But that's mostly how I keep in contact with these people. And the, you know, the family members that I met for the first time over there, like, we're chatting on Facebook and stuff. So, you know, there are so many ways to keep in touch now that it's a lot easier than I think it probably used to be.
Thank you. I just got another one too. That's now that you have taken this trip and devoted so much time to your studies, do you find rose mauling patterns and elements in non-Norwegian art?
Oh my gosh, yes. Everywhere. You see it all the time. So I, as you mentioned at the beginning, I work at a resort called the Greenbrier Resort in West Virginia, and it is known for its just like crazy, crazy interior design. Dorothy Draper was the interior designer, and then followed by Carlton Varney, another interior designer, and they love patterns and bright, bright colors. And so I will find myself just sitting in a chair at work and being like, the upholstery on this chair looks just like Hallingdal or something. Like, it's got the same, you know, there are other artists who will be able to talk way more succinctly and more educated about these, that question. But, you know, the art that came to Norway, somebody went somewhere and saw something and brought it back with them, and like, or they saw these plants that exist in other places and they were influenced in the same way that people who see these plants elsewhere might be influenced. So, you know, there's Baroque style, there's Rococo style, like all of these things are traveling all around. And so you will see similar things popping up everywhere.
Well, thank you. I have a question that has popped up in the chat. They are wondering about the colors of rose mauling. They're not seeing any pink and purple or turquoise. Is that tradition, or those colors just not work with rose mauling?
You know, that is such a good question too, and it's something that I have had a push and pull relationship in learning, because again, we talk about respect and respecting that source material. And no, it's not a traditional thing to see in those older rose mauling pieces, because they didn't have access to those pigments. And so you will see colors that they had access to, the greens and the reds, and the yellows, the oxides. And, but I love turquoise and I love magenta and I love glitter and rainbows and all that sort of stuff. And so I love trying to incorporate those things, but that again brings in that question of, does it stop? Is it no longer rose mauling when you use those colors? I don't know. I don't think I can answer that entirely myself, but for me, the main point of these folk arts is to like add beauty to everyday objects that you see and you use around your house. And so if having a turquoise something or other painted on a box that you hold your recipes in or something, if that's going to bring you joy and make you think of your heritage and whatever, like I think there's a place for that. So yeah, I say go for it, but I don't know.
Thank you. That was a very diplomatic answer. Well, I'm waiting. So far, I believe we've answered all of the questions in the Q&A portion.
Right.
I've checked the. Sorry, I'm checking the chat right now. I apologize. I believe that we've got to any more questions. I want to put it out there. If there's any more follow-up questions that if anybody wants to put out there, or I can, it was such a great, great presentation you gave. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you again so much to Vesterheim. Thank you, Greg and Maddie, for being here and hosting today. And thank you to everybody near and far who has been here to listen to me jibber jabber on. It was really fun to share you know, what I've been up to and what I got to do this past year. It was really a blessing to be able to experience these things and now share it with all of you. So thank you so much.
But thank you. I'm just so thankful for you and all that new work that you put in for us. And it was just so great to see it all. So I just have to do one little speech about, you know, how to close out the thing. But yet again, before I start that was so amazing to see. And is there anywhere we could see the work as you keep going? Or
great question. I should have said that before. So I am on Instagram. That's probably if you want to see some of the videos that you saw today, or some more videos that I haven't done. So my Instagram handle is at Marit. So MARIMARIMARIT. I don't know if somebody, one of my family members, can pop that spelling in the chat.
It's on there. They're already on top of it.
Great. Then you can follow me on Instagram. That's probably where you'll see me put most of my stuff.